started. So a little bit about me. My name is Sierra Williams. I used to be Sierra Leach. I graduated from Bryce Valley High School in 2015, and I went to college right after. I met my sweetheart that first week of college, and we've been together ever since. This is him right here, and I, of course, had to add pictures of my babies. The middle is my little rescue kitty, Simba. He's my little cuddle bud. And then on the right is my little wild child, Wakanda. She'll be a year old this month.
Are you
going to
cry?
I know, why? She's so big. I just wanted to say thank you guys so much for being here. It shows that you're interested in taking care of your body and your oral health, and I commend you on that. So I'll just get started. These are the objectives I hope to cover over the next 45 minutes to an hour. I want to be able to let you see the link between your oral health and your systemic health. When I say systemic health, that means the overall health of your body. I want you to be able to recognize between oral health and oral disease, so that maybe you'll be able to recognize the signs when you need to get help. And I want you to express the importance of good oral home care. I want you to express the importance of going to a dentist annually. And I want you to be able to provide the necessary means of taking care of you and your family's oral health needs. So we will begin with a video. So I want you guys to be thinking of how can oral health help protect your body against disease progression. So let me pull that video up.
Can cleaning your teeth protect against diabetes and heart disease? With beating heart rate, by researching the factors that increase your risk of heart.
Let's
try and circulatory disease.
One
of these factors is gum disease. BHF-funded researcher Professor Jerry Linden is studying.
You want me to come up there?
I practiced this 3 times, and now, of course.
Thousands of people to see if they have gum disease, and if this makes them more likely to develop coronary heart disease.
So, okay, we are just going to
set up
like an input.
Yeah, let's just leave this up here.
Let's see. If not, we can go on without the videos and I can just kind of explain to you guys. It's just nice to have that visual of what's going on. No, I think it'll be okay.
Against diabetes and heart disease. With beating heart rate, by researching the factors that increase your risk of heart and circulatory disease. One of these factors is gum disease. VHF-funded researcher Professor Jerry Linden is studying thousands of people to see if they have gum disease, and if this makes them more likely to develop coronary heart disease. Professor Linden found that those with moderate to severe gum disease had a 69% higher risk of developing type 2 diabetes.
So, we were told to prepare for a video malfunction, so it's okay. We'll be fine. That was just a nice visual of what is happening in our mouth. It's just to kind of show you that our oral cavity is the window to our body. So with the bacteria, there's always bacteria in our mouth. And that bacteria has the potential to get into the rest of our body and cause damage. One thing that the video showed was the effect on your heart. So with that bacteria that's sitting on your teeth, as it causes little micro ulcerations down into the gingiva, it can get into the bloodstream. And what happens is when it gets into the bloodstream, it goes straight to your heart, right? And that bacteria, if it's doing damage in your mouth, it's going to be doing damage in your heart. So you can actually increase your risk for cardiovascular disease. That same plaque that builds up on your teeth builds up in your arteries, and you can clog your arteries as well. And then those little bad bacteria, they go straight for your heart valves, and they can actually cause a disease called infective endocarditis, and it can be fatal if it attacks your valves. So again, just to reiterate, our body has a defense system, and when something is attacking our body, what happens is our body sends out these inflammatory factors, and it causes inflammation. And so when we have that active gum disease, it's an active infection. So our body's sending out these inflammatory mediators. They're going to our mouth as well as the rest of our body. And that inflammation for a short time can be good. Say you get a cold. That's when you get like your fever and your runny nose. And that's short-term inflammation. And that's actually good because it can help kill off those bacteria and your body can recover. But with the bacteria in our mouths, no matter how much inflammation our body causes, that bacteria is not affected. The only way to get rid of the bacteria in our mouths is through mechanical removal, like brushing your teeth and coming in to get your teeth cleaned. So all your body's doing is causing this chronic inflammation that's actually doing damage, more damage than good, and it's going throughout your entire body. So the video that we were watching was going to talk about two diseases. It was going to talk about the heart as well as type 2 diabetes. These are also other diseases. It can actually cause low pregnancy or low birth weight and premature labor in pregnant women. So it's really important that as soon as we find out that someone's pregnant, we like to make sure that they have all the education they need and so that they can take care of their teeth and not affect their baby in any way. It increases your risk for respiratory disease, chronic kidney failure, as well as rheumatoid arthritis, osteoporosis, and obesity.
I was told that if you go in the dentist and you're pregnant and you're not showing them, they can tell you. The dentist.
Yeah, so hormones have a lot to do with how your gums respond. I even see it in menstrual cycles, and when those hormones go up, it's a lot messier with the gums. They become a little more unhappy, and I know even with me, I have to take a little better care of my gums during that time. But pregnancy is a huge rise in hormones, and it can affect the gums in a big way. So another one I wanted to point out is Alzheimer's. We've been studying Alzheimer's and trying to figure out what causes it for a really long time. And in January of 23rd of this year, they came out with a big breakthrough. And what they did is they took subjects who had Alzheimer's. Oh, so Alzheimer's for you guys, what happens is people's brains, as they get older, they start to deteriorate and they can't remember things very well anymore. It gets to a point where they can't remember their own family members. So it's a really sad and scary disease. And we want to figure out what causes it so we can stop it and prevent it. Anyway, so in this study that they did, they took subjects who had had Alzheimer's in their life, and after they passed away, they looked inside their brain. And what they found is a bacteria called Porphyromyronas gingivalis. What that bacteria is it's a very aggressive and destructive bacteria that's found in all periodontal disease cases. And so that shows us that somehow this bacteria got through two different barriers. It got through the gum barrier and it got through the blood-brain barrier. And that destructive bacteria was all over in these subjects' brains, causing deterioration and speeding up the progress of Alzheimer's. So I'm not trying to say periodontal disease causes Alzheimer's. We know Alzheimer's has a lot to do with genetics, but what they're figuring out is that gene might not be you're going to get Alzheimer's. It might be that your body's more susceptible to inflammation. And more susceptible to these diseases, so you need to be more on top of it. And of course, we can't look inside of ourselves and see what genes we have, so we all just need to make sure that we're keeping our bodies at pristine health as much as we can, so we can prevent this and live as long as we can, and a healthy long life. Does anybody have any questions so far? It's a lot of information I'm trying to throw at you. You're crying. So there's a lot of research that I've had to do in my 2 years at this program, and then my teachers also teach me all of this stuff as well, because they do research and teach us. All right, so we're going to do a little activity. It's called a think, pair, share. I want you to take 1 minute and think about this question. What does oral health look like to you? So I want you guys to think about that for a minute. What does healthy mouth look like? And I've got prizes when we go to getting answers. Healthy mouth? Oh, 1 second.
I know.
Okay, wait. Take 2 minutes and discuss with people next to you. Kind of share ideas a little bit. So talk to each other. And then you flip it over and you can scrape forward and scrape all the bacteria off. So our tongue is like a shag carpet, is the best way we like to say it. It's got all these finger-like papillas. The bacteria just love to hide down in there. And that's where the main source of bad breath is, if you don't, if it's not like the periodontal bad breath. So, you guys all had really good answers. So now I'm gonna tell you what we look for in a healthy mouth. What we look for is the color pink. And when we look, we wanna look around like this area. We want no red or dark red areas down there. Down here is fine, because it's a different kind of tissue. But up here, we're looking for pink. We're also looking for knife-edged papilla. And what we mean by that is the gums that come in between your teeth are called papillas. And we want those in sharp, perfect triangles, so there's no black spaces, and so we can't see through into the oral cavity that way. We don't want to see any bleeding. It's always the joke that you go to the dental office and they are the ones that make you bleed, right? But actually, in the tissues that are around your gums, there's no blood vessels there. So unless you were to actually lacerate your tissues or cut down into your tissues, well, I'll come right back to you, okay? Then that's the only way we would see bleeding. And you know that. But all those pinchy feelings, if we ever pinch you, there shouldn't be any blood coming from that. The reason we start to see blood is because when the bacteria sit down on these tissues, they actually make micro ulcerations deeper into the tissue where the blood vessels are. And that's why any little stimulation like flossing or brushing, if you start to bleed, that means there's bacteria and you just gotta keep brushing and flossing to clear it out and let your body heal. I think you had a question first. I don't know whose teeth these are. Google image. Did you have a question? Sweet, same question. You guys must be sisters. All right.
I have a question.
Yeah.
I can see through this area. How do you correct it? Just by better care? Mm-hmm. I floss every day.
Uh-huh. So what has happened is either I have it a little bit too, and my reason is from the orthodontics when they were moving my teeth. They didn't go together the perfect way, and it's not a huge deal for me because it's just a little bit, of a space. But I would have to like look at your X-rays, of course. But you may have had some bone loss, and what happens with the bone loss is, I'll get into this, of course, later. When your bone loss starts to go away, your gums come with it, and it raises up. And once that's gone, you can't get it back. So, and then I'll show you right here. Oh, another thing we look at is for stippling. So that's when we're looking at like the color. Do you see it's kind of more of a matte? There's not light shining back off as much. I'll go to the next slide and you'll see the difference. So this is diseased gingiva. This is kind of a severe case. This is what I'm talking about with the light shining back on us. It means the tissue swelled up and is shining light back at us. But we're also seeing, these red magenta areas where the gums, it just doesn't look happy, right? It's so irritated from all this bacteria. I mean, you can see the plaque that's up there. We also look for blunted papilla. This means the papilla don't come down and knife-edged anymore. They're more blunted off and rectangled off. We see bleeding. We see the glossy. We see bad breath. We see that bacteria stinks. You may have painful chewing. If your teeth are loose and they're pressing up a little bit more, you could have painful chewing. You could lose teeth, and you'll see recession. I'll go a little more over recession, why it's bad. But recession is where these gums should be down here. We shouldn't see any of this root structure. What happens is as that bacteria irritates the gums, they start to pull away. And so they'll start showing more and more of the root. And then possible loss of structure. So, I just taught you what diseased gingiva looks like, but this could also be diseased gingiva. You could have periodontal disease with this. Because periodontal disease is a chronic disease, you could have it and not even know about it. In fact, the CDC has done a study where 85% of Americans have gum disease, which means gingivitis or periodontitis, and they don't even know. And that's just the amount of people who come into the dental office. There's a whole population that don't even visit the dentist. So I assume that statistic is higher. But again, that's 85% of Americans that have this chronic inflammation going, doing damage to their body, and they don't even know about it. And they can't. So if they don't know about it, they can't do anything to stop it. So even if you have no pain, and there's no outward symptoms, it doesn't mean that there's not disease going on in there. And that's why you need to come to a dentist and have us do our assessments with the tools that we need. So I'm going to talk about the things that cause these diseases. Does everybody know what plaque is? You know what plaque is? It's that fuzzy stuff. Do you ever get that fuzzy stuff on your teeth? When you eat and you don't brush? Your food on your teeth? Yeah, so plaque is that fuzzy stuff that grows on your teeth. What it is it's... it is a family of bacteria, and they start to colonize on your teeth, and they grow exponentially. There's a really cool YouTube video, I can't access it, that shows the progression over 8 hours. Just 8 hours. I mean, you're awake more than that in a day, and it grows like crazy. It's really gross. But plaque can be removed with a toothbrush and floss, so you can remove this stuff by yourselves at home, and that's what we want you to be doing, and we hope you're doing that 2 times a day, right? And it's the cause of dental decay and periodontal disease, as well as other problems. Like we talked about, this plaque can get into your arteries and heart as well. So the other one is calculus. Does anyone know what calculus is? And it's not math. This is the dental calculus. So calculus is calcified bacterial plaque. So when that plaque sits on your teeth for a amount of time, it starts to harden and calcify into the tooth. And once that's happened, you can't get it off with the toothbrush or floss anymore. It's stuck on there and it's constantly irritating your gums, and you can't get it off. So do you know that the bacteria that sit on your teeth, they'll form a fuzzy layer first that you can get off, but if you don't get it off, it puts out a hard layer, and then it really like sticks its ground into your teeth, so you can't get it off anymore. And it's just hardened plaque and hardened bacteria, hardened bugs. So that is why you come to us. That's what I'm in school for, is I'm learning how to go down into your gum tissue, and I pop those suckers off without doing any trauma to the rest of your mouth. And it may not necessarily cause cavities, but it can cause periodontal disease, which I don't want to say one is worse than the others because they both do damage, but periodontal disease is what's going to determine if you keep your teeth in your mouth or not. When I say periodontal disease, it's the umbrella term for two different diseases. There's gingivitis and there's periodontitis. So first we'll go over gingivitis. Gingivitis is the inflammation of the gingiva. And when I say gingiva, I am talking about the gums, your gums, okay? So as you can see, the plaque is built up around this gum line, right? And it's really irritating this tissue right here. You can't, it's all red, shiny, inflamed. And one thing I want to point out about this, and I'm going to say this, and then I'm going to contradict myself a little later. Gingivitis can be reversed to complete health. So if you have this and you haven't progressed onto periodontitis, you can reverse this if you get the right treatment and you start taking better care of your teeth. You can go back to exactly how you were and you're just fine. But I don't want to make that sound like gingivitis is this okay place to be, because it is that first step to periodontitis, which is a much more serious disease. So as soon as this is happening, you want to make sure you get the treatment and we can stop it where it's at, because once we progress to the next step, we can't get back. And we will go to that next step. So this is periodontitis. This is a more severe disease. So this is when that bacteria has moved down into more the deeper tissues, and it's made our body pull away from the tooth. And what happens is we start to lose the bone. And what's important about that bone is what's holding our teeth in. We wouldn't be able to chew if we don't have any teeth, right? Can you imagine grinding up your meat and drinking it, trying to get your protein?
Ew.
It'd be gross, huh? And it can cause a lot of other problems, like depression. I know a lot of elderly who have lost their teeth suffer with depression because they can't enjoy that. Food is a big, I don't know about you guys, but food is a huge deal in my life. I'm always looking forward to the next time I eat. So keeping our teeth is really important. 47.2%, remember that number, million Americans, adults have periodontitis. That's slight, moderate, or severe. That's almost half of Americans have lost some bone. And the one thing I want to say about this is it's irreversible. Once that bone has been lost, you can't get it back. Of course, there's other things that we won't get into. There's bone grafting, but it's a different kind. Just know that you can't get your overall bone level back up once it's gone. And then, of course, you get possible tooth loss with it, and there's four stages we'll go over really quick. Okay, so early periodontitis or stage one periodontitis can look like gingival health or gingivitis, but what's happening is there's pockets starting to form. And to show you an example of pockets, I always like to do this with my patients. I'll put this on. So my hand is your tooth, the part that you can see, and my sleeve is the gums holding in your tooth. In every person, I can reach down inside the gums 1 to 3 millimeters. That's just our normal human anatomy. You won't feel me down in there. Every time you've gone to the dentist, they've done this. They stick, and here's another little example. We stick our probe down into the gums. And what happens is we want to see 1 to 3 millimeters, but as we get this bone loss, the gums start to pull away as well, because the bone level, so this right here is bone, this is our gums, this is the probe. As the bone level gets lower and lower, I can reach down further and further. So that's what I'm looking for, is how deep down. Another thing about that, and I'll go over this later, is we can keep 1 to 3 millimeters of our pockets clean. Once we start getting in these deeper pockets, it's really, really hard to keep clean, and so you're not going to be able to keep up on your health as well. And then of course, slight bone loss. Okay, stage two periodontitis, our pockets will deepen. We'll start seeing some recession, so we'll start seeing more of the root surfaces. And we'll start to get a little bit of an embrasure space right here is what that's called, where we see there's a space in between the teeth. And of course, we'll see some more bone loss. My neck has to crack. Stage three periodontitis, this is where pockets deepen again. We might start seeing pus form in the pockets. We'll have advanced bone loss. Our teeth will start to get wiggly, and they're gonna fall out. And this isn't like your little teeth that are falling out. Once you lose these adult teeth, there's not another set waiting to come back in. You're gonna be without your teeth. And then in this stage, you have 4 or less teeth loss. Stage 4 is when you have only less than 20 teeth remaining. You might have trouble biting because there's no teeth to occlude anymore, which means there's no teeth to go together to grind up your food. This one might be missing it, so you can't grind up your food with it. As well as advanced bone loss, pus forming pocket, and pockets deepening. So how does periodontal disease develop? This is where bacteria has been left on the teeth, whether in plaque form or calculus form, and it has irritated the gums, and it's gone down into the connective tissue and the bone. And what happens is the body recognizes that something's not right, and so it sends out this inflammation, but over time that inflammation isn't doing anything. So what it does is it says, okay, we can't fight this, let's get rid of the tooth. So it actually starts to pull the bone away. So it's our own body's doing it to us because we're not helping it out. So it starts to pull the bone away because it's trying to get rid of the tooth, because that tooth is the infected part, right? And again, periodontitis is irreversible. We can't go back. The risk factors for periodontal disease, smoking has a lot to do with it. This makes our blood vessels in our mouth constrictive, so we can't get blood and nutrients to our tissues anymore. It also slows down our healing, so we can't heal ourselves as much. Hormonal changes such as pregnancy and menstruation can have a lot to do with it. Diabetes, it's a two-way street for diabetes. It's actually a really big deal if someone comes in with diabetes, because usually when they have diabetes, they've got periodontal disease. It's a two-way street, like I said. Periodontal disease will affect how we control our blood sugar, and if diabetes is an inflammatory disease, so it's also coming back to affect our mouths. So to get one under control, we can try and get the other one under control. Anything in compromising our immunity is going to compromise our ability to heal ourselves. As well as medications can dry out our mouths, and that's not very good, and genetics have to do with it too. And that just means we want you to just be more diligent. If any of these apply to you, just be more diligent in taking care of your teeth. So treatment for periodontal disease, there's two different treatments. I had a really good YouTube video for you guys. It kind of let you visualize it a little bit more. But for gingivitis, we do, and for healthy, I should put up here, we do what's called an adult prophylaxis. The dental hygienist removes calculus and plaque in 1 to 3 millimeter pockets. So we'll just go down with our instruments and we'll do a quick little debridement and get everything clean so you guys can do your job at home. And for periodontitis, it's a little more intense. It's called SRP, or scaling and root planing. You'll know you've had this. They call it a deep clean, and they'll get you numb. So if you've ever been numb for cleaning, you've probably had been treated for periodontitis. That means we're removing calculus and plaque in 5 millimeters or deeper pockets. And it can be a little painful. That's why we like to numb you up. Anesthesia was used. Okay, so any questions so far? We're almost there. Okay, so dental caries. This is also known as cavities. Caries is just what we use as dental professionals. That's just the term. So if you ever hear caries, that's what we're talking about. So the stages of tooth decay. First, I want to point out the three layers of a tooth. You have the outside is the enamel. That's the most mineralized substance in your body. It's harder than bone. So that's the very outside of your teeth. That's what you see when you see the white. The middle layer is called dentin. It's softer. And then the middle, the very center, is called the pulp. That's where all your nerves and your blood vessels are. That's what's keeping your tooth alive. So this is a healthy tooth with plaque starting to form, right? And then there starts to be decay. So it starts to eat away at your tooth, and it gets into the enamel, and it starts to eat away. Then you see decay through the dentin. That's when it's gotten pretty deep. You'll usually really want to get these fixed, because once it gets through the dentin and into the pulp, that means that tooth is dead, and you're going to have a pretty bad infection going on, because that bacteria is now into your bloodstream. That's when you're going to need a root canal and a crown, and it turns into a really pricey procedure. So it's another reason we really want you to go to the dentist, is these beginning cavities may not cause you pain. You may not even know that you have them, but if you're at the dentist, they'll recognize and they'll fix it up for you, and it's a lot cheaper than when you wait and you have to pay a lot for an emergent treatment. There was a little boy in Maryland in 2007 or 2008, and he actually passed away because he had a cavity that got into the pulp of his tooth. And it got infected, and he wasn't able to see a dentist. They couldn't afford it at the time. They were trying to get into Medicaid, and it was a big ordeal that way. But that little boy ended up dying because that infection got into the bloodstream, made it to his brain, and he had an infection in the brain and died. So it's a really big deal that we take care of our teeth and not let it get to this point. There's three things that need to be present for cavities to start. There has to be the bacteria, and I guarantee there is always bacteria in our mouth. No matter how hard we try, there will always be bacteria. Some are worse than others, of course. So we'll always have that, the better bacteria, always. And then fermentable carbohydrates. So pretty much anything that tastes good is going to be a fermentable carbohydrate. That's like sugar and breads and pretty much everything I have back there. So go brush your teeth after this. Anything sticky, that is just gonna feed those back the cavity bacteria, as well as susceptible tooth structure, which is just any tooth structure. So this is a little more intense way of saying things, so for anyone not science-minded, you can tune out for a little bit. So it starts with cariogenic foods, which is cavity-causing, it's breaking that word down. Cavity-causing foods go into your mouth, and it feeds the dental bacteria, and they grow because they're eating, right? They're eating and they're growing as a family as well. And as they go through these metabolic processes, they form an acid. And the acid is what actually starts to break down our tooth structure and demineralize it, and which leads to a cavity. Now, non-science-minded people come back to me, and I'll explain it how I talk to my kindergartners. I always tell them, you have sugar bugs living on your teeth all the time. And when you feed them sugar, they eat and eat, and you know what happens when you eat, is you poop. And these sugar bugs poop on your teeth, and that poop starts to eat away at your teeth, and they give you cavities. So you need to make sure that you're brushing those sugar bugs off and not letting them poop on your teeth. That sound good? They always think it's really gross. Okay. So pH. So our saliva has a certain pH. You guys probably don't know what pH is, right? Do you know what I talk about when I say an acid?
Yes.
Kind of. If you think about eating a lemon, do you know how it's a little more sour, a little more hard on the mouth? Okay, so that's kind of what I'm talking about. A lemon is going to be super a big acid, okay? Water feels good in our mouth, right? That's a very neutral. That's what we want, is neutral. Right here in this green. So every time we eat and we put something into our mouth, it drops our pH down. And the reason we care about this is because cavities love this area. They love the acid. And so when you're feeding them, or when you eat, you're not only feeding them, but you're also giving them a good environment to grow. I talked to you about recession and why that root structure, we didn't want that to be shown. That's because the roots are a lot weaker, and this is why. So the enamel, that hard outside, to have a cavity start in there, it needs to drop down to this area, right? But for a root structure, it only needs to drop down here before it starts forming a cavity. So it's more likely you're gonna get a cavity on your roots than on your enamel, if you have both shown. What I wanna say about this is frequency is worse than quantity. Of course, we don't want you to eat a ton of sugar because we are advocates for your overall health, but as it goes for your teeth, frequency is worse. So for an example, if I want a soda today, right? It would be a lot better for, it would be a lot worse for me if I took a sip of that soda every hour and I finished it throughout the day. Because what's happening is every time I take a sip, I'm dropping my pH level and I'm not letting it go back to neutral. I'm taking a sip, taking a sip, taking a sip, and I'm letting that those bacteria that are gonna cause cavities in my mouth work for a longer period of time. You a soda drinker?
Soda drinker, and I drink as slowly as I can.
Well, that's, I mean, we want you to try, make it a goal of the not drink it as drawn out, but if you can't, we always say drink water. Have a water and a soda, and every time you drink that soda, take a sip of water, because that water is going to be your buffer, and it's going to bring you back up to a neutral faster. And just swish around, and it's also good after you eat, always have a water with your meals. But take a look at the water that you buy, if you buy water bottles. What I have today, this is 7.3, so it is very neutral. Things like, I just looked this up because we always drink Dasani, and Dasani's down here in the threes. It's super acidic. So take a look at the bottled water that you're drinking. Tap water, you're probably usually pretty safe.
Where do you find this information on the...
Google. Just pH of... Nestle Pure Life. I just googled that.
Google it and it tells you?
Mm-hmm. Yep, right there on the top. So yeah, just put it into Google. You're pretty safe with tap water though. And speaking of tap water, we're gonna go into fluoride. Why is fluoride important? Does anybody know why fluoride is important?
Cleans your teeth.
It what?
Cleans your teeth.
Okay. Anybody else? Yeah, kind of does, huh? Okay, so the importance of fluoride. There's a little bit of controversy with fluoride, so I do want to hit on that a little bit. So fluoride is a naturally occurring substance. It helps to form strong teeth during development. So while our kids, you guys are growing your adult teeth right now. So we want to make sure that you're getting some fluoride to help those teeth come out strong. We also want you to keep getting that fluoride because even if your teeth have erupted and they're not developing anymore, it still prevents tooth decay and it can strengthen your teeth. As well as if you have a little cavity starting, if you put this, the fluoride that you get at the dental office, when they put that on, it has such a high percentage of fluoride that if you put it on a little cavity that's starting, it actually kills the bacteria right then and there. And it remineralizes it. It puts in the right minerals to the tooth. It actually makes it stronger than if. So you know when you break a bone? You break a bone and when they heal it, they say that part is stronger. That's kind of how it is. And then we also want you to have daily application of fluoride. That is with your toothpaste. That's a lower percentage of fluoride. So we want you to get that on every single day, twice a day. So there's different methods of receiving fluoride. There's topical, which means it's put directly onto your tooth. That's when you have toothpaste, you're putting that right onto your teeth, and your teeth are absorbing it that way. as well as mouth rinses and the professionally applied in the dental office, that yummy, it's not really yummy, I pretend, but that stuff that we paint on your teeth at the end of the appointment kind of makes your teeth sticky. That stuff is really awesome. And then we have the systemic way. So this is like foods. Fluoride is actually found in a lot of foods that you eat, like green veggies, fish. There's a whole bunch of foods. You can get it through supplements, but I want to really emphasize only if your dentist prescribes this. That's where we start running into trouble, is when people go get fluoride supplements and they don't eat it. And then there's water fluoridation. So that's when your community will put fluoride into the water that comes out of your tap. So you have it at your fingertips right there. We want this to be at 0.7 parts per million. What people are worried about, there's a lot of theories out there, but the only proven detriment that fluoride can cause, or harm that fluoride can cause on your body, is fluorosis. And that's just on your teeth. What happens is it'll turn your teeth a little white and kind of etched a little bit. But that will only start happening at 2 to 4 parts per million. So we're just saying at 0.7 parts per million, that's what we want your water to be fluoridated. We're not saying those higher ranges up there. I do want to point out, Bryce Canyon water is not fluoridated. So you can always Google what bottled waters have fluoride in them, or different resources to get fluoride waters. And also talk to your dentist and see what they think. Home care. So what are the pros and cons of practicing oral home care? You guys can just shout this out. What do you think? What are some good things about
brushing your teeth?
Yeah, what are some good things about brushing your teeth?
Waffle.
Yeah, that's good. What about like keeping your teeth clean, right? Keeping the plaque off? Okay, now give it to me. What are the cons of brushing your teeth twice a day and flossing?
It tastes
gross after.
Mm-hmm, yep. Orange juice after is nasty.
Gatorade.
All right, it's time consuming for some people. Yep, I get it all. So a few facts before we begin. I told you guys every healthy tooth has a gingival sulcus. Remember when I reached down into my sleeve? 1 to 3 millimeters, right? I can do that in every one of your teeth. Toothbrushing, when you brush your teeth, that can clean 1 millimeter down into the gingival sulcus. But there's still 2 millimeters that aren't getting clean even when you brush your teeth 2 times a day. And that's why we say to floss. We don't say to floss just to annoy you. There's actually a reason. Because you can't clean all the plaque and the bacteria off without doing a combination of the two. So flossing can reach 1 to 3. Brushing and flossing can only clean 25% of your mouth surfaces. If you think about it, you're not brushing your cheeks, you're not brushing the top of your mouth, but there's still bacteria on it. So that's why we also suggest having an antimicrobial mouth rinse, just to get that overall clean feeling. One thing I do want to say, if you notice you have a dry mouth throughout the day, make sure you're getting a mouth rinse with no alcohol, because that'll dry your mouth out more, and having a dry mouth is not good. Your oral cavity at all. We want you to brush 2 times a day. We want you to brush for 2 minutes. Does anybody know how long the average brushing time is?
2 minutes.
That's what we want you to do. Nobody actually does it. Does anybody want to take a guess?
30 seconds.
30 seconds, that's close. 45 seconds. That's the average amount of time. Yeah, so we want you to be brushing 2 minutes. That's not even half. So that's why an electric toothbrush is awesome, because it'll notify you how long you've been brushing. I don't think I was brushing for 2 minutes before I got my electric toothbrush. Mm-hmm. 2 minutes is kind of a long time if you think about it. And we want you to be flossing every night. We want you to floss once a day, and before bed is the best time to do it. Because if you're just getting in there, I mean, I always suggest to people, buy those floss picks and keep them in your car, and while you're driving, just floss your teeth. Just get them in there every once in a while and clean out those pockets. And then use mouth rinse every night. That way you're getting more antimicrobials in and getting the bacteria cleared off, as well as getting some fluoride everywhere. So the different techniques, you can be brushing and you can be flossing, but if you're not doing it right, you're probably not getting all the bacteria off. So I have videos, and I'm so sad, but what happens is, for the Bass method, this is the most common method that we suggest to people. Like I said, we want you to be able to clean down into the sulcus of your teeth. So what will help get the bristles down there is pointing the bristles of your toothbrush 45 degrees down into your gums. Can everybody kind of see that? Sorry, it's like super far away. And then what we want you to do is do soft circles all around.
My toothbrush may be bleeding.
Then you need to be brushing more. Remember what I said? You shouldn't be bleeding. Okay, so yeah, just soft circles and point them down into your gums, or up into your gums if you're doing on this side. So that's the Bass method. And then C-shaped flossing. So, I can't even remember the statistic, I wish I did. But it's like 10% of the population flosses and like 1% does it right. So what we call some people are clickers, because they'll just click in and out of their teeth, but that's actually not doing anything. You're getting the contacts of your teeth, awesome. But like I said, the bacteria is hiding in between your gums, down inside your gums. So what we want you to do is when you get it in between your teeth, you're going to form it to the tooth like a C. Can you see how that's kind of wrapping around the tooth? And you're going to slide it up and down, down into the gingiva, and then up. So we're getting everything. And then when you're done with that side, you're doing it on this side. So that's C-shaped flossing. Okay, kids and toothbrushing, this kind of goes with you guys. So for you guys, you can kind of start doing the 45 degrees down soft circles, yeah. But maybe for like Harper, she's still pretty young, so what we just tell them is just to do soft circles, just around the mouth. And parents, you can have them like try and let them show you that they're doing it, and then maybe you could take the toothbrush and kind of just go over some areas. We want you to start the habit young. Begin brushing as soon as that first tooth is erupted. You can begin flossing as soon as two teeth have touched together. And you can begin using fluoride toothpaste as soon as the first child's tooth erupts, but just use a smear amount. It used to be said that we didn't want you using fluoride toothpaste on children that young, but we figured out the benefits outweigh the risk with it. They're going to see a lot more benefits than the small risk of them having any toxicity. But this is if you just use a smear amount. So we just want you to tiny little smear on it. And then a technique you could use is the mirroring technique. So have your child stand in front of you, and as you're brushing, they're going to copy you. It's a copycat thing. It's kind of a game for them when they're young, and that way they kind of can see the method of getting all the areas in the mouth. So you want to point out the areas that need to be brushed. So you want to make sure they're getting the outside and the inside of the tooth and the top of the tooth, as well as the tongue. You want to make sure they're brushing their tongue and getting the habit. Okay, so I'm going to ask these questions really quick. What impact does proper brushing technique have on your oral health? So what does brushing right do for your mouth?
Where's the bacteria?
Yeah, you're getting all the bacteria. So what is that doing for your overall health? It's keeping your mouth clean. It's keeping the rest of your body from getting any of that bacteria into it. So now we're going to do some trivia. What is the brushing method that calls for the toothbrush to be tilted at a 45 degree angles in small circles?
Bass.
Yep, you're right. Good job. Bass. Can you remove calculus with the toothbrush?
No.
Good. You need a dental hygienist. When should you start flossing your child's teeth?
When they touch.
Yeah, good job. You guys are awesome.
Why don't we touch teeth?
Okay, see your dental provider. We are just about there. Home stretch. So visiting your dentist, getting that preventative care from your dental hygienist is super important, because even if you are, I have a patient that comes in and she says, I brush twice a day and I still have calculus when I come in. But it's really hard to make sure you get all that plaque off every single night. So it's a 50-50 partnership. You come in, we're gonna do our job of clearing out that calculus and stuff that you can't do at home, but then we need you to go home and keep up on your oral health so that when you come back in, you keep improving rather than being in the same situation and even digressing. So we wanna make sure that you're coming in for your dental hygiene cleanings. It'll also, getting your teeth cleaned and taken care of them is gonna save you money on emergent treatments. And then, of course, if you come in, the dentist will be able to diagnose and treat cavities before they become beyond repair. And the dentist will also be able to diagnose and treat oral cancer early. I always, so ladies, we are told to get a to perform a mammogram on ourselves once a month, I think it is. And I am that person that's, I'm a control freak, so I like to make sure I know exactly what's going on with my body all the time. So of course I follow it. I have a day where I do it. And while I do that, I also take a look in the mirror when I'm brushing my teeth that night. I look at what my mouth looks like. Oral cancer is going to, usually, most of the time, it's going to pop up on your tongue, mostly the back side of your tongue. It can be the back side of your tongue. It can be also on the floor of your mouth. But take a look around all, like your cheek tissues. Pull your lips up and down and take a look at the area that you don't really see. And just get an idea of what healthy looks like for you and what's normal. And if anything pops up that's not normal, go in and get it figured out. But if you're coming into the dentist, they should be doing those exams on you every single time that you come in. Because catching and treating oral cancer early and quickly can raise your 5-year survival rate from a 50% to an 80 or 90%. So it's a really big difference. I mean, would you rather have a 50% chance of survival or an 80 or 90% chance? It's kind of a no-brainer. And then it's kind of self-explanatory, but we cannot treat infection without treatment. Some people think, I have this disease, but I don't want to go back in for treatment. I'm just going to brush harder. But like I said, you can't get that calculus off, and you can't get that clean slate without letting us do our job and treat you. It's a long process, but we want to make sure that we get your oral health under control because it has an effect on your whole body. So what are the benefits of seeing an oral health provider on a biannual, which means 2 times a year basis, on your oral health? So what's good about seeing a dentist?
Huh?
Yeah, to see if you have cavities and figure all that out, huh? As well as cancer. As well as systemic health, it will help your overall body stay healthy. It can be able to catch cancer and keep you alive. Okay, the dental resources around you. I really tried to find some places in Cedar. If you guys know of any, let me know. But I couldn't find anything on Google. So I just know St. George. St. George has a doctor's volunteer clinic. You can get medical and dental care, and they go off just donation basis. You pay what you can at the time. Then we have St. George's Family Health Care. They go off, you bring in proof of income, and then they base what you need to pay off that income. So they'll go, like if you're paid a little lower, you'll pay a little less. And then, of course, there's the Dixie State University Dental Hygiene Clinic, where I just spent my 2 years. We have reduced prices because it is students working on you, but I mean, it'll be the most thorough care that you get because you have students and instructors doing it at the same time, or right after each other. So it's very thorough. We're not going to let you leave with any calculus on there, I promise. But I do want to mention they are 3-hour-long appointments, and there's usually multiple appointments. So this isn't something that you would want to be interested in unless you had that commitment to give, because it is our grade, so no shows are really not good. But if you're ever in, move to St. George, it's really awesome to help out your students and if you have time to go in and get your teeth cleaned. Okay, so what we learned today is we learned that your oral health is linked to your systemic health. We learned the difference between diseased gingiva and healthy gingiva. We learned about cavities and the importance of fluoride. We learned how the different methods to brush and floss your teeth. And we learned to see a dental provider at least once a year. And these are the objectives. I hope I lived up to your standards today, and I hope we got everything taken care of. Any questions? It was kind of a lot.
Mom?
I just gave you my 2 years' worth. Yeah.
Do you recommend any mouthwash? I've never used mouthwash.
Yeah. Do you have dry mouth? Do you notice if your mouth
sometimes.
Is dry?
Sometimes.
So my favorite for dry mouth is ACT. ACT, that is really nice for dry mouth. It actually is aimed for dry mouth to help. Otherwise, I really like Listerine. They use essential oils for their main ingredient, and I really love it. That's my favorite kind.
What are some problems with dry mouth?
What can happen when you have dry mouth?
Mm-hmm.
So it'll make that plaque sticky, and it's hard. So we want that saliva flow to be going, because it'll help move and lubricate things inside your mouth. But when that plaque just sits there and it's sticky, it's gonna cause cavities a lot faster. Cavities love that environment, as well as it's just uncomfortable. It can be painful for the person with dry mouth. I have this weird week. I wonder if it was a medication I was taking. Because medications, if you're taking a medication, you're probably gonna have dry mouth. But I had like this week of dry mouth, and it was awful. I couldn't swallow. I had trouble swallowing food. But yeah, just having dry mouth is overall not good for your mouth. Our natural function is to have saliva, so anything different than our natural function is gonna be bad. So we don't want anything to cause that dry mouth to get worse. Yeah. Any other things?
Fluoride help her popcorn teeth, or are they just doomed?
What is that?
Does fluoride help her popcorn teeth, or are they just doomed?
So what do you mean by popcorn teeth? Like kernels getting in it, or?
No. Dylan.
What do you have? Now, what do you mean by pop?
Does it not have enamel on it? Is that what it is?
Well, they covered it up.
Mom, they covered it up.
Oh, I guess they did cover it up. Did they cover it all up?
Yeah. There's a little bit back there. Did they say anything about enamel hypoplasia?
I think that's what it is.
Is that what it is?
They covered it up.
I don't think fluoride. I mean, it always adds strength to it. But I think there would, has a dentist talked to you about like a treatment plan for it, or is it?
Yeah, severe. So this last time, you it just put fluoride and sulfur.
Okay.
Yeah. Diamond, so something, they painted it all black last time. I was trying to just build it.
Okay. They painted it black, sorry. So that, I think that would be the silver diamide fluoride. That's going to be a different kind of fluoride, but that's really awesome. It does stain black, yeah, but they covered it up. That's awesome. Yeah. I want to know. Let me know what they do and how they treat that. That's more on the dental side of things. We just learned how to recognize it so we can tell the dentist, but that'd be interesting to see what the treatment is.
And eventually the fallout of the cleansing.
Oh, man. That's so miserable. Is that just her first permanent teeth that have come in there? Dang it. Well, yeah, keep going to the dentist and have them help you, okay? Any other questions? Well, thank you guys for coming and spending your time with me. I know it's not the most interesting stuff, but I hope you learned something new. Do you want to pass out the pre-test really quick?
Yeah.
And take the pre-test.